Get started. Praise the Lord. Well, thank you, Jesus. All right, so we're going to be in Revelation chapter 4. We've been doing a study on the book of Revelation. Many of you have been with us for a while. And we're just kind of moving through. I say the book of Revelation, really we've been talking about end time events. And tonight I actually want to talk to you about the seals. I think we're going to kind of go through all the seals tonight. And but right here in Revelation chapter 4, I also want to mention, you know, the concept about a pre-tribulation rapture. We've been kind of throwing some of these things around, or at least I have been throwing around the thought of, well, just what if? And, you know, sometimes people don't like what ifs. Well, you know, I'm not trying to stir anybody's. Well, I am kind of rattling people's cages a little bit because I want us to try to think outside the box. And the only reason that I say that is because, and this may not be you. This may not be where you are or where you live, but for the longest time, I just believed pre-tribulation rapture just because I was told pre-tribulation rapture. It wasn't that I didn't study it. It wasn't that I didn't try to see it, but the reality of it is that I don't know that I studied it enough for myself to be convinced. So what I decided to do this time was just to go back to the text and let the Word of God speak. It doesn't mean that I don't still believe and hope for a pre-tribulation rapture, because I don't know about you, but I don't want to be here during the Great Tribulation. Nevertheless, I want to be prepared and solidified in my heart and in my mind for no matter what we have to go through. As a matter of fact, I'm going to explain a little bit of that to you tonight. I'm not so certain that we don't see right now what's going on, and there's too much really to talk about it all right now, but layer upon layer upon layer of deception. And what I mean by that is that there's forces at work on this earth. You do what you want with that. Don't give the devil glory. I'm not giving the devil glory. But I'll tell you one thing, he's a formidable foe. And I don't think that we've been aware of the fact that he's been busy at work. And his work's a whole lot more organized than what we've given credit for. So what I'm trying to say is that, and I'll explain it a little bit more, that I'm not so certain that there's not a pre-tribulation tribulation on the works. And what I mean by that is the forces of evil. And what I mean by that is that just because you're an American and you've been comfortable in your American way of life doesn't mean it's always going to be that way. And I think that the American church has been lulled to sleep to believe that they're just going to sit there and eat cotton candy or candied apples and have their fellowship meetings and everything's just going to be fine until we float away in the sky. And what I'm trying to tell you is, and nobody wants to hear this kind of thing in the modern church, but what I'm trying to tell you is that I wouldn't be one little bit surprised if we don't see some great tribulation our own self. I mean, and what I mean by that is some tribulation before the Lord comes back and have to face some of the things that even the apostles faced and the early church fathers. Now, I don't know about you, but I need to make sure that I got some grace flowing and operating in my life. I want to be prepared for that. I don't want something just to fall upon me and then it just ruins my whole mindset of what all my theology was based on. And then the next thing you know, I put it in my book when I wrote it, a mass defection happens. Can you imagine just for one second? I mean, no, really. I mean, I don't want to take too much time with this, but do you realize that most people in the church right now would never even, I'm talking about the modern church, would never even contemplate or consider a thought like this? Do you realize that most people in the church right now are so consumed and worried about social gatherings and about creating an atmosphere where everybody feels so comfortable to be able to come to church that they would never consider the fact that the church may have to endure great persecution, much less speak it from behind the pulpit, because it might make the people get upset and fretful, and it might cause chaos and anxiety in them. Well, but I'm here to tell you that what happens if it does happen? What happens if there is great tribulation that falls upon American soil? What happens then? Well, then, now the next thing you know, all these superficial Christians that weren't really saved and didn't have any roots in them, all of a sudden we see a mass defection. People are like, oh, it wasn't real to begin with. Or they're being prepared for a grand deception anyway. You understand what I'm getting at? And you know, I could go on and on about that, but we don't really have time, at least not right now, to do that. So here we are in Revelation chapter 4. Verse 1, and the scripture says, after this I looked, and behold, a door was opened in heaven, and the first voice which I heard was as it were of a trumpet talking with me, which said, come up hither, and I will show thee things which must be hereafter. So I just want you to know that tonight I want to at least mention some things about a pre-tribulation rapture, okay? Because we want to cover the whole thing. And then you're going to be left with the idea of what is it that that seems right to me. I'm not going to make your decisions for you. We're going to try to cover it from various aspects. And then when it's all said and done, hallelujah, whatever happens, we're ready. Amen? All right. And so what I want you to see here is that in chapter 4, verse 1, it says, after this. Well, first, let's look at the concept of the trumpet. If you have your Bibles, I'm going to turn to 1 Thessalonians chapter 4. Starting in verse 13, it says, "But I would not have you to be ignorant, brethren, concerning them which are asleep." Now that's terminology that speaks of Christians that have died in the faith. All right, that's not talking about they're taking a nap. They've died in the faith. It says that you sorrow not, even as others which have no hope. So if your family member is a born-again child of God and they happen to die on this side of eternity, on this side of the rapture, on this side of the end times, we all mourn our loved ones, but you're not supposed to be so sorrowful of heart that you can't make a comeback. Amen? The truth is that if they've died in Christ, the Word of God says to be absent from the body is to be present with the Lord. There is no purgatory. There's no second chance. The Word of God doesn't say anything about a purgatory. The closest thing is that it talks about Abraham's bosom in Luke chapter 16. That place is gone now. The Word, Paul said, to be absent from the body is to be present with the Lord. When you die, it's appointed unto man to die once, and then the judgment. You either die covered under the blood of Jesus, or else you die outside of the blood of Jesus. And if you die outside of the blood of Jesus, then you die outside of the covenant with God. And Jesus preached on hell, and he said, it's a place where the worm doesn't die, and there will be weeping and gnashing of teeth. I don't want to go there. Lord, help us. Amen. To stay focused on you, precious Jesus. And so, anyway, what it says right here, though, is talking about the trumpet. And it says right here, talking about them that fall asleep. Don't have sorrow as those that have no hope. For if we believe that Jesus died and rose again, even so them also which sleep in Jesus will God bring with him. You know, it's probably an important thing, not to get too carried away, but to try to make at least a point that the word rapture, we get caught up in the word rapture a lot. And yes, the word rapture is not really even in the, it's not in the Bible, the word rapture itself. There's a Latin word where we get it from called rapturo. But nevertheless, the idea is certainly there, right? I mean, this is what we're reading right here. This is the most evidence-based passage of Scripture that speaks of a rapture event that's going to take place. I mean, it's worded here. You can't deny it. Nevertheless, what I want you to know is that more so than thinking about this word, we should understand that this concept is talking about the resurrection. You remember whenever I preached on Lazarus, I think it was last week, I can't even remember what I preached last week, but I preached on Lazarus. And you know what Jesus told Martha? He said, "You know your brother's going to rise again." She says, "Yes, in the last day." No, you know, Martha, you're missing. I am the resurrection and the life. Amen? If you believe in Christ, the Word of God says that you will come forth from the dead. Amen? Because he died and rose, see, he has power over death. He said that in John chapter 10. He said, "I have received a commandment from my Father that I can lay down my life, but that I can also pick it back up again." Amen. He had to receive the commandment from his Father because he had no sin in him. He had no sin in him, and the wages of sin is death. And because he had no sin in him, there was no wage of death that he owed. And so therefore, when he died and he laid down his life willingly as a sacrifice for your sin, death had no right to hold him down. That's why it says in Hebrews 2, verse 14, that because the children were partakers of flesh and blood, he also became the same, that he might become us so that he might die for us, I'm paraphrasing, so that he might destroy the one who had the power over death, which was the devil, and so that he might remove from you, from me, from you, the fear of death that we've been bound by all this time. I don't know about you, but it wasn't long after I was a kid and realized what death was. I was already thinking about it. Oh Lord, am I going to die tomorrow? I remember asking my daddy, and he was just so tough as nails. "Daddy, what you going to do when you die?" "Well, boy, when everybody got their time, got to come up sooner or later." "Well, Lord Jesus, make sure you know Jesus before your time comes up." Amen? Anyway, resurrection and life. That's what it says right here. It says, for if we believe that Jesus died and rose again, even so them also which sleep in Jesus will God bring with him. For this we say unto you by the word of the Lord, that we which are alive, that's talking about us right now, and remain until the coming of the Lord, shall not prevent them which are asleep. In other words, if you're alive when this event takes place, you're not going to go before those that have already died in Christ. He says, for the Lord himself shall descend from heaven with a shout, with the voice of the archangel, and with the trump of God. You see the connection there to the trumpet, all right? And the dead in Christ shall rise first. Then we which are alive and remain shall be caught up together with them in the clouds to meet the Lord in the air, and so shall we be. So shall we ever be with the Lord. Wherefore, comfort one another with these words. Also in 1 Corinthians chapter 15, verse 50, there's another reference to the trumpet sound. 1 Corinthians 15, verse 50, it says, now this I say, brethren, that flesh and blood cannot inherit the kingdom of God, neither doth corruption inherit incorruption. Now, you know, it's just interesting. I always get these thoughts into my mind when I'm reading. You know, whenever Jesus told Thomas to stick his finger in his hands and to thrust his hand in his side, he said, can you see that I'm flesh and flesh and bone? And he didn't say anything about blood. And so what I'm trying to tell you is that it says flesh and blood won't enter into the kingdom of God. But yet at the same time, Jesus had some sort of a bodily form. He was able to eat. He was able to really able to walk through walls. He sat down and at the Sea of Galilee, he had fish cooking on fire whenever Peter and John and them were fishing. And he sat there and he ate with them. And so in some way, shape, or form, the glorified body still has some kind of external structure to it. They didn't really recognize him, though, so I think we're going to look, you know, different than whatever the case. But the point is that flesh and blood won't inherit the kingdom of God. I believe at that point, that's just my personal opinion. I haven't found it. But it's going to be the Holy Spirit's going to be like the blood for us. See, that's what the Word of God says in the book of Leviticus, chapter 17, I believe it is. It says that I've given you blood. Now, this is... we're talking 1,400 years before Jesus, all right? God's talking to the children of Israel as they about to embark in their wilderness experience and prepare a tabernacle for them. And he talks about the altar and the sacrifice. And he says, I've given you blood to make atonement for the soul. He said, because the life of the creature is in the blood. And so the plan of redemption, from the beginning in the garden, we don't need to go back that far right now tonight, has been about the shedding of blood, because the life of the creatures in the blood. When his blood was poured out, the shedding of blood is basically synonymous with the giving of his life. It's about the sacrifice. Amen? So when you hear the word blood, cross, death, sacrifice, it's all synonymous. It's all about Jesus giving his sinless life, shedding his sinless blood in your stead. But when he talks to Thomas, there's no talk about blood. He says, I'm flesh and bone. And so it's a glorified body. And it says, flesh and blood will not inherit the kingdom of God, neither does corruption inherit incorruption. Verse 51. Behold, I show you a mystery. We shall not all sleep. There you go again. We're not all going to die, but we shall all be changed. And he says right here, in a moment, in the twinkling of an eye, at the last trump, for the trumpet shall sound. It's going to happen. And the dead shall be raised incorruptible, and we shall be changed. And he goes on to say, for this corruptible, talking about this sinful body, flesh that was born of Adam. That's what it's talking about there. It may not say it, but I'm telling you, that's what it means. This sinful body born of Adam. You're a child of Adam's fallen race. All mankind has come forth from the loins of Adam, born in sin. You got a sinful DNA. We're all in the same boat. Oh, the preacher preaches too much about sin. No, we're all born in Adam. We're all born sinners. That's why you got to be born again. Don't walk out of here tonight without knowing that you must be born again. No matter what the preacher tells you tonight, you need to be reminded that Jesus died in your stead. He shed his precious blood on the cross, and you got to receive that for yourself. Your mama can't get you in. Your daddy can't get you in. You got to receive Jesus by faith. And I'm not talking about intellectually. No, I'm not talking, I believe it. Yeah, a 33-year-old Jewish man died on two pieces of wood outside a city called Jerusalem 2,000 years ago. I'm with you. preacher, check that box. No, it doesn't work that way. You can't just believe intellectually. The Bible says that you believe there's one God, you do well. The devils also believe, yet they tremble. You must believe with your heart. The Word of God says in Romans 10 that you must believe with your heart and confess with your mouth the Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. Listen to me. You got to believe on the inside. What does it mean to believe? To entrust oneself. Jesus entrusted himself. He gave self. And now he's looking for you to give yourself to him. Amen. Help us, Lord. Help us to give ourselves to you.
Thank you, Lord.
Don't leave this place without receiving Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior if you haven't already. But if you receive the Lord Jesus Christ, then the corruptible, verse 53, is going to put on incorruption, and this mortal must put on immortality. You're going to receive a glorified body. Hallelujah. One that won't wear out. Praise God. I wanted you to see those two references to the trumpet of God. As a matter of fact, what's interesting is that coming up next month is the Feast of Trumpets. I'm not going to talk a whole lot about that because I want us to try to preach on that or teach on that before it gets here. But we have talked a little bit in the past about the seven feasts of the Israeli people. Really, I was watching a teaching the other day and I thought it was really good. The teacher pointed out that, no, these are God's feasts. We keep saying that they're Jewish feasts. It's just that the Jewish people are the only ones that recognize them. They're God's feasts. Amen. And nevertheless, the point is, I'm not saying that we need to go get a shofar and start blowing it or whatever the case, which I did see somebody do that on Bourbon Street one time. Remember that, Aaron? When we went to with Lance and you poured that oil up in there. That oil flew all up in the heavens. I was like, man, this dude's radical. We about to go tell some people about Jesus. You remember that? That was cool. Anyway, I can't blow one like that, though. But so the Feast of Trumpets is coming up, and there were four feasts that have already taken place in the first month of Beeb, which is also called Nisan. And in the first month of the Jewish calendar, four of the feasts have already been fulfilled in the first advent of Jesus. What does advent mean? It means in his first coming. The first time Jesus came, he fulfilled the first four feasts. What were the first four feasts? Passover. He was the Passover lamb. Paul says it in 1 Corinthians 5:7. Passover was fulfilled. Jesus was the lamb that was slain and his blood was shed that night. Unleavened bread. What does that mean? He had yeast. Leaven is yeast. Jesus had no sin in him. It represents his sinless body. Feast of First Fruits. Jesus resurrected on the Feast of First Fruits. After that, I didn't even know that. And I know it now. And that's whenever I got to jumping about the feast. Then, 50 days after the Feast of First Fruits, the day of Pentecost, the Holy Spirit descended upon the church and the church age was birthed. Amen. All four of those feasts were fulfilled in Jesus' first advent or his first coming. In the seventh month, which is just really interesting to me, that the number seven is the number of completion and fulfillment, which is also the month of Tishri for the Jewish calendar. And extending into the other month, there's three more feasts to be fulfilled. The first one is the Feast of Trumpets. I'm not saying it's happening this September, but what I will tell you is this. Every year from now on, now that I've gotten a revelation of the feast, I'm ready when it comes time for the Feast of Trumpets to be prepared. That it may be this time, it might not be, but I'm telling you, I believe with all my heart, you might not know the day or the hour, but I know you're going to know the season, and I believe that he's going to rapture us out on the Feast of Trumpets. That's what I believe. I'm not going to get into what the other two mean because I'm already running out of time. But listen to me, the trump of God, amen, is connected to the rapture of the church. And so I want to be fair to the pre-tribulation rapture. This is a very significant finding in my opinion. Chapter 4, verse 1, after this, I looked and behold, a door was open in heaven. And the first voice which I heard was as it were of a trumpet talking with me, which said, come up hither and I will show thee things which must be hereafter. Now, it says right here, after this. Well, after what? After the first three chapters. I'll put a map up here, and it's probably difficult for you to see back there, but I'm just going to get outside of the camera's view. I know people probably hate it when you do that, but this is actually the area of Israel down here where I put this little red line, and I put a red arrow leading to this area here. This is called Asia Minor, okay? Paul would have traveled in a boat all around here. But at the same time, this is where the seven churches of the book of Revelation are located, in Asia Minor. And so I just thought that maybe I would go shrink it in a little bit and show you those are the seven churches of Asia Minor. And if you go back and you can read we could just pick one of them and explain, because he's saying after this. So we've had three chapters of teaching on churches, seven different churches. And you know what? Let's just go back a little bit. And it says, right, well, let me just kind of tell you what's happening. The Word of God says in the book of Revelation in chapter 1 that this is the revelation of Jesus Christ, which was given unto him by God, and that it was communicated through his angel to John, who was on the Isle of Patmos. So John was the beloved disciple. He was the oldest one that remained alive, and he was banished to an island called Patmos because he was being punished for preaching the gospel. Whenever he was on this island, it said he was in the Spirit on the Lord's day, he received a vision. And as he received this vision, it was opened up to him things that must happen hereafter. And so, but the message first came that you need to deliver this message to these seven churches. So there were seven literal churches that existed in Asia Minor during this time frame that most scholars believe that John the Beloved would have been like the bishop or overseer of all these churches. At the same time, when you begin to study the characteristics of these churches and the adjectives that the way that they're described, you begin to realize there's more to the story. That it's really describing also the condition of the church, maybe during the entirety of the church age. In other words, the church of Ephesus, you lost your first love. Throughout the church age, there's been individuals in the church that had a fire for the Lord that lost their first love, and the Lord's constantly calling us to come back. Amen? At the same time, there's been churches throughout the entirety of the church age that had a zeal for the Lord, and then after a period of time, they backed off. And even as we move to the book of the last chapter in Laodicea, he says, you say you're rich and increased and have need of nothing, and you don't even know it, but you're poor, you're miserable, you're wretched, you're naked, you're blind. Come and buy salve from me, that you might anoint your eyes and you might be able to see. Come and buy garment of me, white garment, that you might be clothed in righteousness. Come and buy gold from me that's been purified in the fire. And the truth of the matter is, that's the last day's church. Jesus said, I'm standing on the outside and I'm knocking. But he's not even in the church. The church is doing their own thing and they haven't even let him come in. Lord, help us. And that's what's going on. So it looks as though Laodicea is a perfect picture of the end times church. You say you're rich and increased and have need of nothing. The church has all the chandeliers and all the golden chairs and all the technology and all the things that you could possibly want. But they don't really invite Jesus in. They're not really doing the work of the Lord. I'm telling you, it's a social gathering in most churches today. And so that's what's going on after these things. And one of the things I noticed as I went through and I counted it, the word overcometh is used 8 different times. He says in chapter 2, verse 7, he that has an ear, let him hear what the Spirit says unto the churches. To him that overcomes will I give him to eat of the tree of life. In chapter 2, verse 11, he says, he that has an ear, let him hear what the Spirit says to the churches. He that overcomes shall not be hurt of the second death. Second death is the one you do not want to be part of. That's judgment. That's whenever those whose names aren't written in the Lamb's Book of Life find themselves in that lake of fire that Jesus wasn't scared to preach on, where the fire burns hot, the worm doesn't die, and there will be weeping and gnashing of teeth. It says in verse 17, he that has an ear, let him hear what the Spirit says unto the churches. To him that overcomes will I give to eat of the hidden manna, and will give him a white stone. I just want you to see that the word overcometh is utilized multiple times. And even in one of them, he says in verse 21 of chapter 3, to him that overcometh will I grant to sit with me in my throne, even as I overcame and am set down with my Father in his throne. I had to read that one to you because I wanted to leave you with the hope that maybe you don't feel like you're an overcomer right now. Jesus doesn't expect you to overcome on your own. He that overcometh, even as I overcame. Amen? He's the forerunner. He's the pioneer. He's the one that went forth to begin with. He's the one that blazed the trail. He's the one that did the work. And if you and I learn how to trust in him and keep our faith in him and stay focused on him and not be deterred from the left or the right, amen, we'll receive the grace that we need in order to overcome just as he overcame. So John the Beloved said, after these things. After what things? After the message to the three churches of Asia Minor. Sardis was just one of them. But as you can see, I don't know if you can really see, but Pergamos, Smyrna, Thyatira, Sardis, Philadelphia, Ephesus. having a hard time reading. Laodicea. Seven churches that the message went after these things. See, that's another reason why people believe strongly in a pre-tribulation rapture. After these things. This three chapters represents, in most scholars' minds, the church age. Because what they'll tell you is that the word church isn't used again in the entirety of the book of Revelation. And the word church isn't used again. The word saints is hagias, separated ones, holy ones, which many people tell you could also represent Jewish people. But there will be believers in the tribulation. In other words, people that knew the word of God, that didn't make the rapture, whenever that rapture takes place, and they'll be left with the reality that they missed, and they will turn their heart to Jesus like never before, amen? And they will be willing to die for the faith at that point in time, I can assure you. And God's grace will be there to strengthen them and to encourage them. And when I say believers, maybe they weren't really saved, I don't know, but that they knew enough in their head to believe, amen? And then whenever that day happens, they'll give their heart. I'm a firm believer that you either in or you're out. People may not like that about my preaching, but listen, I was saved in a Pentecostal church. And you know what? I believe that there's been a fight, not a fight, but maybe it's a healthy discussion between what the Baptists, many Baptists would believe and what the Pentecostals would believe. The Baptists believe that once you're saved, you're always, it's unconditional eternal security. I believe in eternal security. I just don't know that it's unconditional. And the reason I say that is because the Word of God is clear that even about Hymenaeus and Philetus, and that their error or their teaching has corrupted the faith of some. And even the whole book of Hebrews, it says, holy brethren, partakers of the heavenly calling. And it goes on to talk about the fact that there were holy brethren, which the letter was written to, that were turning their faith back towards temple sacrifice because they were being persecuted greatly. The point is that no, the devil can't snatch you out of God's hand. Amen. And you're not going to lose your salvation. But don't think that sin lapping upon the soil of your heart day after day, week after week, and year after year can't begin to erode the soil that's protecting the root. And the next thing you know, like the Word of God says, you apostatize from the faith. You turn your, you don't even realize it. Right. Well, how far away your heart is. And maybe I'm wrong on that. And it's okay. I don't know. I'm not the Holy Spirit. I don't know whenever somebody's not saved anymore. Thank God. But I know this. I know that it definitely ain't the way that the Pentecostal used to say. Every time you make a mistake, you're out. You know, every time that you failed, you were out. No, that's not how the covenant works. The covenant works that Jesus is the obedient one. He's the one that was obedient to the Father. He's the one that was obedient unto death. And it's my faith in Him that allows me to come into covenant with Him. And the only thing that can destroy that is if my faith in Christ is destroyed. Amen. And so I just want you to know that even as He overcame, amen, we also can overcome. But it says right here, after these things, after that church age. And so we're talking about a pre-tribulation rapture. And I noticed that, you know, I pointed these things out here. After this, after that church age, there was a door that was opened in heaven. There was a voice of a trumpet. We discussed the trumpet. It says, come up hither, and I will show you things hereafter. So the thought would be, hereafter this church age. Now, one of the things that that I wanted to point out is that John, under a pre-tribulation teaching, is representative of the church. Like, in other words, scholars and commentators would say that John the Beloved is representing the church when he comes up hither. You understand what I'm getting at? And so he's representing the church when he comes up hither, but then when he gets there, he sees some things. And one of the things that, now I want to slow down just a little bit, and I made this graphic, and I don't know if it'll help you or not, but I'm starting to kind of like playing around with this little thing, and I hope it doesn't irritate you. But so this is a church, and what I want this to represent is I want it to represent the church age. Now, we talked about the feasts. Remember that? I mentioned the four first ones to you: Passover, unleavened bread, Feast of First Fruits, and then Pentecost. The Holy Spirit just descended right there. That's Pentecost, whenever the church age began, when the Holy Spirit descended in the upper room, amen, and those people were filled with the Holy Ghost, right, and they'd be filled with the power of God to begin to preach the gospel of Jesus Christ. And so the church age was birthed at that point in time. And so we're trying to think about the concept of the pre-tribulation rapture. And so the church age began on the day of Pentecost, and it's lasted through. And what that little icon right there is, or that little graphic, is the signing of the Daniel 9 covenant. Now, we talked at length of that. We can't get back into it again, but we have videos on that. In the essence of what I'm trying to point out of that Daniel 9 prophecy is that the Antichrist signs a covenant with Israel, and that begins the last seven-year tribulation period of the seven-year of that week's prophecy. Now, one guy I was listening to recently made the point that he doesn't believe that you'll necessarily know if that agreement's signed. He's probably right. In other words, does it mean that it's going to be broadcasted on the news? No, it doesn't. But that doesn't mean that once that agreement is signed, that that's not what really kicks in or restarts a prophetic time clock. Once again, when you break down that Daniel 9 prophecy, to me, it's clear that that is the initiating factor that begins that last seven-year period, if indeed we have a seven-year tribulation. If we feel like we can count a seven-year tribulation, and I feel like we can, then whenever that ink is hit that paper is whenever that process starts. Now, the next thing, though, is the blowing of the shofar. What is that? That represents the Feast of Trumpets. That represents the rapture of the church, if we're talking about a pre-tribulation rapture. These things could happen simultaneously. I can't prove that they would, but I'm just trying to say that this is a scenario that the covenant is signed between the Antichrist and Israel, and the next thing you know, God pulls the church out of here. So we're coming up to the Feast of Trumpets next month. Theoretically, this deal could be in the works, because see, the enemy of your soul understands all these things. He understands all the feast days. He understands the way that God operates. As a matter of fact, in the Word of God in Isaiah 14, when it said that he was going to ascend above the congregation, the very word there is the same word that speaks of the feasts. The enemy of your soul understands the way that God operates, and he understands the Word of God. And so what I'm trying to tell you is that this covenant is signed, and this is a pre-tribulation scenario. The shofar is blown, or the Feast of Trumpets takes place, and the rapture of the church happens. So the rapture of the church happens, and then from there it begins this great tribulation period. So up to this point we've had the church age, now we have the rapture, then we start the great tribulation, that seven-year period, and what we're about to talk about now is the opening up of these seals, okay? And so you get a little bit of a picture of what I'm trying to say here. Church age, the pre-tribulation, for some of you that, you know, are familiar with it, you know, don't get bored, just bear with us, have a little patience. And so a pre-tribulation would specifically say that once that happens, that rapture, that great tribulation period, that seven-year period starts. Now, one of the things that I'm going to point out coming up in a couple of weeks is I'm kind of looking at, like, after this last seal, we'll talk about it next week, something starts happening. To me, it's a little bit different. And, okay, but let's not get ahead of ourselves. So when John went up there, it says, after these things, come up hither. When John went up there, he saw elders. He saw these elders in Revelation chapter 4, verse 4. It says, and round about the throne were 24 seats. That means 24 seats. And upon the seats I saw 24 elders sitting clothed in white raiment. And they had on their heads crowns of gold. And so I got a picture of white raiment. Listen, the scriptures are clear throughout. And there's really a theme that runs through the entirety of the scriptures about being clothed upon with righteousness. Most scholars and commentators would agree and tell you that they believe that in the garden before the fall, Adam and Eve would have been clothed in a swath of God's glory. And that when they didn't know they were naked before, because they were covered with the glory of God. The presence of God, their communion with Him, their union with Him allowed them to be covered with the presence of God. But yet as soon as sin was taken into themselves, they realized that they're naked. And what do they try to do? They try to take fig leaves to cover their nakedness and their sinfulness. But then what does God do? He says, no, fig leaves aren't going to work. The work of man's hands, I don't care how holy you try to be, how righteous you try to be, your works will never cover or this problem that now has been interjected into the human race called sin. And what does God do? He provides skins for them. He takes an innocent animal, that had nothing to do with Adam and Eve's sins, and he cut that animal, it doesn't say he cut his throat, he took that animal's skins and he covered Adam and Eve with the skins of that innocent animal, typifying and representing the day thousands of years later that Jesus would come on the scene, innocent, didn't have anything to do with your sin, didn't have anything to do with my sin, but laid himself down on the cross to pay the penalty. So the Word of God says that they would have been clothed with the glory of God. We believe they become naked in sin. They try to cover themselves with fig leaves. God covers them with the skins of an animal. God sends Jesus. The Word of God says in Galatians 3:27 that those of you who have been baptized into Christ Jesus have clothed yourself with him. You've put him on. So now you've been clothed with the righteousness of God when you put your faith in Christ. When you put your faith in him and his sacrifice, the Lord put Christ on you. And now when the Father sees you, he doesn't see your failure. He sees the righteousness of the Holy One. Amen. That's a good word right there. Doesn't mean you can do whatever you want. Lord, help us all. Amen. But nevertheless, when the Father sees you, he sees righteousness. Hallelujah. Well, the Word of God says throughout the book of Revelation, it talks about white raiment. We're going to see another scripture where it talks about it, where they've been clothed upon. Remember the wedding parable? Where it talked about how there was a king who had a wedding feast for his son, and he invited the people to come, and they were busy. I got work to do at the house. I got some more stuff to take care of. I got to go plow the field. And the king said, well, if they don't want to come in, then you just go out everywhere in the highways and the byways. He said, I already got the food. The harvest is coming. The feast is coming. Go find whoever you can and bring them in here. And then at one point in time, there was somebody that was trying to get in, and he didn't have a wedding garment on. Wedding garment, robe of righteousness, the white raiment, all representative of the righteousness that is given to the believer. Amen. So in this scripture, when it talks about these elders, 24 elders, most commentators and scholars would tell you that these are representative of the church age and really even the Old Testament saints. 24 seats, 12 tribes, 12 apostles, and all clothed in righteousness. By the way, you know, this was something that I didn't really know for the longest time, so let me just share it. You know, God's plan has never changed. The scriptures are in unity. And what I want you to understand is that the same way that somebody's saved today is the same way they were saved back then. You're still saved by faith in the shedding of the blood. In the Old Testament, they looked forward to the day that Messiah would come. Now, they missed the concept that he would actually be the lamb that was slain according to Psalm 22. But nevertheless, they would put their faith and transfer their guilt to the sacrifice of that animal. And they were waiting for the day that Jesus would come. Now that Jesus has come, we look back to the day that Jesus, the Lamb of God, took away the sin of the world. And so the plan of salvation has always been the same. It's just that the Old Testament saints had to wait till Jesus died, and they went into that place called Abraham's bosom and waited until Jesus died, because the Word of God says in Hebrews that the blood of bulls and goats cannot remove sin. But once Jesus died on the cross and their sin debt was paid, the Word of God says in the book of Ephesians that he descended before he ascended, and he led captivity captive, meaning he went down there, amen, and he brought those people with him to heaven, amen. So we're talking about a robe of righteousness, and we're talking about being clothed upon. These 24 elders had white raiment, and they're representative of. Now, one of the interesting things to me is I'm kind of looking at, well, this is what I was going to talk to you about a while ago. I'm kind of looking at a post-trib. Let me try to make sure I can explain this right. Pre-wrath. Rapture. When I say I'm looking at it, I just find it's an interesting spot in the scriptures. And it starts off in Revelation chapter 7. And I want to explain a little bit of what I'm trying to explain to you tonight. In just a second. That the first part of the tribulation, to me, it represents things that mankind can do. Don't get me wrong, God's ultimately in control, and I'm going to explain myself. But after that sixth seal is opened up, man can't fake that. That's the wrath of God falling on mankind. And I don't believe that the Lord's going to leave us here for that. The Word of God says we have not been appointed unto wrath. Jesus took our wrath. Amen? And so what I'm trying to tell you is that now at that point in time in Revelation 7, you don't just see 24 elders clothed in white. You see multitude upon multitude upon multitude clothed in white. And so to me, it's just at least interesting and something to think about. All right, but we'll get there whenever we go. So these 24 elders were clothed in white raiment, but they also had crowns. Now, I thought it was interesting when I began to do a little bit of study on the crowns that these crowns were crowns of gold. So this is an eternal crown. Whenever the word gold is used in the Bible, it speaks of eternal. And the reason why is because gold is a metal that does not easily oxidize. And so it has lasting value. But this word in the Greek right here for this crown is actually Stephanos. And the word, you see what it looks like? It looks like the wreath. You see that? Another way to say this word is that it's the victor's crown. It was the kind of crown that was used in the games. In the Grecian games or the Roman games, whoever won got the victor's crown. Now I got to tell you that we're about to open up the first seal. And when we do, that old boy's got one of these too. His victory is only going to last for a little while, and then he's going to find himself in a lake of fire. Nevertheless, what the crown represents is it represents the victor, the victory, all right? And so, but there's another word for crown, and this is where it says right here, we read it already, but round about the throne were 24 seats, and upon the seats I saw 24 elders sitting clothed in white raiment, and they had on their heads crowns of gold. The Stephanos was known as the victor's crown, and then there's another word, diadem, which was known for a king's crown. And so, Jesus also has a diadem. As a matter of fact, in this scripture right here, it talks about it. In Revelation 19:12, this word here is diadem, meaning the crown of the king. Amen? But so we're about to open up the first seal. And what I want you to know is that the first four seals of the book of Revelation represent, have you ever heard of the four horsemen? I'm not talking about when you use a kid and you watch wrestling. I'm not talking about those four horsemen. I'm talking about the four horsemen of the apocalypse or the four horsemen of the book of Revelation. There's four different horses. There's a white horse, a red horse, a black horse, and then what's called a pale horse. And we're going to talk about that. So we're getting to seal number one. In the first seal, it's a white horse. And this is the picture I chose first. And after I thought about it a little bit more, I said, that's not a good picture. And the reason why it's not a good picture is because it's obvious. Because the guy's got skulls all over the place, meaning that he's deaf. It's not going to be that obvious when he shows up. He's actually going to be a counterfeit Christ. When he shows up, everybody's going to first welcome him. See, he's got one thing, though, is that I liked about this picture is that he's got a bow, but there's no arrows. And the scripture says that he has a bow. And the reason why, I ended up putting this scripture up. Now, I think he's got like a little, got some arrows there on his side. So that didn't work because the scripture doesn't say it. But it's going to be more like a situation where he's going to probably look, I say pretty. What I mean by that is he's going to be appealing. Whatever it is about him, he's going to be appealing to the masses. He's going to offer them something, and people are going to be drawn to his charisma. He's going to have an anointing on him, and it's not going to be a Holy Spirit anointing. He's going to have a demonic anointing. And whenever he speaks, Daniel said he's going to speak with smooth words. His words are going to be very smooth. They're going to be elegant, but he's going to speak in riddles. You're going to hear one thing come out of his mouth, but really what's coming out is complete opposite. It's going to be deception. And so that's the first seal. It's what it says right here, Revelation 6:2. I saw and behold a white horse. He that sat on him had a bow. Notice there's no arrows. So the idea is that first when he shows up, he comes in peace. He's not coming to fight. He's not coming. So at least that's what he says. That's what comes out of his mouth. I'm here for peace. But as we see, quickly. Now, one of the things that I want you to know is that if you go and you read these passages of Scripture, in Revelation chapter 6, verse 2 is where we are. I'm glad that I thought of this because I don't want to. In verse 1, it says, "And I saw the Lamb opened one of the seals." I wanted to make that point. The Lamb is the one that's opening this seal. Amen? Ultimately, I want to make this clear. God is sovereign and in control. I've made this point since we started this series for quite a few times that God, amen, is the one, hallelujah, he's going to use the Antichrist and the Antichrist system to judge this world. He's allowing all of this to happen. We said we learned about that in 2 Thessalonians chapter 2. We're not going to get through the teaching tonight because I'm committed to ending early. But what I want you to know is that in 2 Thessalonians chapter 2, it says that because they refuse to believe the truth, that God's going to send them strong delusion. And what I want you to know and what I want you to understand is that when the Lamb opens the first seal, the first rider is on a white horse and he has a bow, but he's given a crown. Now, see, you notice that? I kind of got ahead of myself. I wanted you to see this, though. This is interesting to me. This goes back to the deception thing that I was trying to explain to you. This woman named Anita Fuentes, she has like a little show that she puts out on YouTube, and she's pretty cool. She comes up with some pretty good stuff. She pointed this out. During the Biden Obama, whenever they were doing speeches for their first race, they chose Denver Invesco Field to do this. And there's this white horse that's at Invesco Field right there. And many people, conspiracy type people, believe that Obama is the Antichrist. I don't necessarily believe that, but you know what? I don't know everything. If he is, I think he's got some hidden Jewish blood in there or something like that. But nevertheless, and she started pointing out how other seals afterwards were broken, how the Red Seal came and, you know, whatever the case. She explained all that. One of the things that I think is interesting, and I'm just trying to make a point, I said this on more than one occasion, that I personally believe that the enemy has a plan. I don't have time to get into using all the terminology about Illuminati and secret societies. All that stuff is real. I've researched it enough to know that there's a very organized work of evil that has been on the face of the earth, that's been operating in governments. I can back this stuff up with scripture. The word of God is clear. Psalm chapter 2, the heathen rage, kings and rulers, they set themselves against the Lord and His anointed. Revelation 17, the seven-headed beast represent kings and governments that have committed fornication with the beast. And so don't tell me that governments haven't been in bed with the liar. He's the one giving them power. That's what's going on. It's not just accidental. They know what they're doing. I'm telling you, there's deception upon deception. And what I'm trying to tell you is there the possibility that there is going to be a grand deception that's going to fake a return of Christ for the counterfeit Christ? In other words, when he does show up, when the first seal opens up, the rider on the white horse is the Antichrist. And he's showing up with a bow, and people are going to receive him, and they're going to think he's the Christ. But in reality, he's not. I've already told you, read to you stories or prayers from the occult. I've read them. You might not have been here. Of like this woman, Alice Bailey, and how she taught all the followers of their form of black magic during the 1940s, to pray a prayer, come Lord of light, come and bring your peace upon this earth, and men will give their wills unto you. Which she's talking about Lucifer. She's asking Lucifer and asking millions of occultists. She says, those of us who know the plan, we're going to get together, millions of us, every day, and we're going to offer this world back to the liar. And what I'm trying to tell you is that they're working there's no other way to say it, they're working their magic. And what I'm trying to explain is there the possibility that there is a pre-tribulation tribulation, almost like a facade, like a layer of deception on top of a layer of deception? I just want to throw that out there to you because I feel in my spirit that there is. And I feel like there's going to be some chaos that's coming on, that's already coming on the earth. And I have a feeling it's going to hit American soil. I just do. And if I'm wrong, then Lord help me. I sure didn't mean to be a false prophet. But I will tell you one thing. That what is interesting to me was I Googled this. Well, I put it right here. I don't need to write it on the board. There's Invesco Field with that horse up there. New York Times, I've wanted to find out, when was the date of this? August the 8th, 2008. So in reality, this month makes 7 years. So what I find that to be interesting is this. And the reason I find that interesting is because the first seal is the white horse. Theoretically, that's when the first seal is opened. You know what I'm saying? Let's stick with our pre-tribulation. The covenant sign, the rapture takes place. But no, we know the rapture hadn't taken place. But the tribulation starts and the first seal is opened. So the first seal theoretically would have been open right here if this white horse of what they're saying, these conspiracy theorists. So then 7 years later is the end of the tribulation when Jesus, according to the scriptures, comes back. And so my point is that I'm not saying anything's happening at the end of this month or even in September, although I'm ready for the Feast of Trumpets. They got a lot of stuff going on in September. And what I want you to know is that to me, once again, I'm telling you, and I'm not saying it's happening now, I just want to make that clear, but is there the possibility that something weird happens coming up and all of a sudden, you know, it would be just about right that this would be a time frame for something like that to happen. But anyway, so that was the white horse, a counterfeit Christ, a bow without arrows, and he has counterfeit peace, and he's a counterfeit king. Now, I do want to close with this. It says right here that a crown was given unto him. Now, the Lamb opened up the seal. So once again, God is the one that's sovereign, and he's the one that's in control. But, you know, I started thinking about this. It's not that I've been thinking about it different just in the last few days, but I kind of connected these two things together. That the forces of evil, just like that woman Alice Bailey, like I told you about, who was saying that invocation, come Lord of Light, come, and that there's been millions of these people through the ages that have been practicing this black magic to bring back. Listen, it's written on Egyptian walls. You understand that? Horus, you probably never even heard of that. We're going to teach that once we get through this series. I'm going to teach the six-part series that I worked on. Horus is the child of Osiris and Isis, and it's written on the walls. Horus is the child that they're trying to bring forth, the god of destruction. And so what I'm trying to tell you is this has been going on for thousands of years, and it's been continued on, but it's been done secretly, like at the Tower of Babel. All this stuff, is you don't have to believe it if you don't want. It's real. There's the enemy is on the prowl. And so what I want you to see, though, is that it's given unto him. Now, God ultimately is the one that allows it to happen. But what I'm trying to tell you is that the enemy is given a crown. And that's what I believe part of the mark of the beast has to do with 666, his connection with humanity. He's using you, just as God, through the Holy Spirit, uses you as a vessel to tell other people about the good news. He's using, the enemy's using humanity as a vessel in order to disseminate his lies. A crown was given to him. They're saying, come, Lord of Light, come, take your reign upon this earth. See, this earth was given to Adam to have dominion over. And when Adam was deceived by the serpent, he basically relinquished his dominion to the enemy. And now, yet still, mankind says, we want you to be our Savior. Those that have been lied to, those that have been, veil and deception has been placed over their eyes, and they're asking for him to come. Now, I got to tell you that there's some interesting things too, because there's another scripture that says that he saw a star fall from heaven, Revelation 9, and unto him was given a key. And so anyway, I just find that to be some interesting information too. But we'll start with seal number 2 next week.